Greetings and blessed day to you once again, people of God. It's the Revelator once again, and hoping the grace and the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ is with you until the end of time. Now, before we enter into today's presentation, I just want to give you a brief recap of what we covered last time. Last time, we focused on the end of time, and we shared these two presentations in a double presentation in which I shared part one and two. And you explained the last signs before the end of time, and you explained also the fate of the last destruction, including the last signs of destruction. And today I want to take you into yet another sermon presentation, another word dimension, which equips your soul, equips your spirit, and strengthens you in your worship system, inside your faith with our Lord Jesus Christ. And today, we want to focus on a very creative dimension, which is titled, Defending the Gospel of Jesus Christ. And obviously, when you are defending the gospel, you are also defending Christ. And inside defending the gospel of Jesus Christ, I want to specify on courage and boldness. Not only courage and boldness, but the zeal inside the Lord's work. And hoping that the Holy Spirit is going to assist me as usual to be enabled to present this sermon as he will in the spirit. Let us get into scriptures. In the book of Matthew chapter 11 verse 2, and it reads, "Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples. This John that has been locked away in prison has been the forerunner of Christ way before Christ had even come. And he has been preaching about one that was yet to come, one whose shoelaces he explains that he was not even worthy to untie, to loose. And finally, the one that he has been preaching about has come. And though there are signs that were shown to John to prove that this was Christ, which include the dove that descended on Jesus' shoulders in the form of the Holy Spirit, the voice that spoke from heaven, there are things that John had set up as standards and principles inside his calling. And his standard was to preach Christ. And he had preached Christ unto the level that he was now in prison. And whilst he was in prison, earlier on, John had preached that I must decrease so that he increases. And he was referring to the one that was yet to come, who was Christ. And this signaled the level of honor that John the Baptist had for the one that was yet to come, who was Christ. Now John hears about the works of Christ whilst he is in prison. But there was still a part in John which many believe that it was a part of carnality or doubt, but I will not take it that way. There was still a part inside John that believed that the one that had come was not Christ. That is another version from another preacher. And another version believes that John had not yet given up his ministry, though Christ had come. And what are the reasons of all these opinions or sentiments from other preachers. It's because John sent two of his disciples to Jesus while he was in prison. And he said unto him, are you the one that should come, or we have to wait for another? Meaning that in another angle, the expectations that John expected about Christ, he preached about the coming of Christ, and now Christ has come. Meaning that there are expectations that John had about Christ, which he expected a manifestation. Inasmuch as there are many, even up to this generation, that still haven't believed that Christ has already come. We are now waiting for his second coming. They still believe that Christ is yet to come. But I believe that John had acknowledged that Christ had come after he had seen the evidence of the dove descending upon his shoulders. He even baptized him and even said, I'm not worthy. But John, the reason why he is sending his disciples to inquire, are you the one who the scriptures say you are going to come? Are you the one, or we must wait for another? It's because John wants to make sure that the one that I have announced to the people is the one whom the heavens has chosen. John also understands that there are probabilities that the one that I have announced could not be the one. And John wants to make sure that he preaches a standard of a gospel that comes to pass. I've been preaching along that Christ is coming. I've preached that this is the one that is going to come and take out the sin from humanity. I've preached all this time baptizing people and making them ready and preparing for them for the one that was preached even by the prophets of old. Now he has come. And I don't want anything to hinder the gospel that I have been preaching. And John sends two of his disciples while he is in prison. And John sends two of his disciples to inquire, are you the one? Why? Because we have got higher expectations about your coming. The reason why John wants to inquire is because John wants to defend the gospel. John does not want anything that he has preached to be tempered with. He has been preaching as a forerunner, eating locusts and wild honey about the coming of Christ. Now Christ has come, and I expect Christ to fulfill his mission. I expect Christ to fulfill his mandate. This is the type of disciple John is. John did not just sit back in prison and say, I have done my part. I have been preaching about Christ. He has come. Whether he's playing his part or not, I don't mind. But John wants to make sure that the gospel that he preached, it has to be delivered. It only doesn't have to be delivered, but it has to be fulfilled. I hope someone is understanding what I'm saying. To the level that even when John is now in prison, he still assigns disciples. I have never seen such a level. I thought that if John is now in prison, he must now relax and just let Christ do his part. John, you have been preaching all this time. Christ has come. Won't you just sit back and relax and let Christ do his part? No. I still need to inquire, are you the one that we have been waiting for, or we should wait for another? Why? Because I don't want to be found on the list of those that are going to be questioned by many about the one that I was preaching about. He has to prove his capability. He has to prove that he is truly the Christ. And this inquiry is not being made by one that is trying to test Christ. No. I'm soon going to get into that part so that you understand that Christ indeed responded to John, so that John would get convinced that it was truly Christ that had come. Why? Because the bottom of the matter is that John wants to make sure that whatever he preached and presented about the coming of Christ is fulfilled. He stands on the word that he preached, and he makes sure that he does a follow-up on the one that he preached about. Why? Because there are men and women that preach a gospel. After preaching a gospel, they go and sit down. There are men and women, after receiving a gospel, they don't do anything about it. When the thief comes at night to steal, he's able to reap everything that they have received, and they don't fight back. John is not the type of disciple whom, after preaching, he just sits back and does nothing. He follows up on the word that he preached, and he wants to know if the one that I was preaching all along is playing that part, and that very part which I preached about. I have been a forerunner of Christ. I gave up my life, and I want to know that if the Christ that I was preaching about, is he the one? And when the disciples of John arrive, they arrive, and Jesus answered and said unto them, go and show John again these things which you do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. Why is Jesus telling the disciples of John what they have seen, instead of just answering a simple question which the disciples of John have asked him? What it means is that the moment that the disciples of John came, Christ started performing certain miracles that he performed at that very hour. And then he told the disciples of John and said, go and tell John what you have seen. And obviously they saw the blind receiving their sight. They saw the lame standing up and receiving strength. They saw the dead being raised. That was an accurate, physical, tangible, and evident answer which John was looking for. Why? Because John wants to defend the gospel. And Christ understands that John is not asking, testing, or asking in a disrespectful manner, but John is asking because he wants to defend the gospel. Why? Because the people, they are still asking John, even while he is in prison, where is the Christ that you were preaching about? Now you are in prison. And John wants to defend the gospel that he preached, that Christ is there. And Christ manifests abilities of the Spirit and demonstrates power at that very moment, and says, I will not just give you this response in words. The Messiah that you have been preaching about has come. And he has come in the demonstration of power. Why? Because there are men and women that listen to the word. You listen to sermons, one sermon after the other. And after listening from one sermon after the other, you go and sit down and you do nothing about it. And even when you have people that start criticizing your mentor, you can't even defend yourself. You can't even defend the gospel that you heard. John is in prison, and he can't stomach the fact that there are still people that want to question him. Where is the Christ that you are preaching all along? To the extent that he is to send his disciples to go and inquire from Christ if he is the one. Not because he doubts, but he is actually trying to say to Christ, you need to give me a tangible answer, which is through the demonstration of power, so that I can be able here to defend the gospel that I have preached. Child of God, there comes a season when you are required to defend the gospel that you have preached. There comes a time when the Holy Spirit has to prove that he is working within you. There comes a time when Christ has to prove himself within you, in the same way that Christ proved himself to John. That for sure, what you have been forerunning for all along has come to pass. The gospel that you have been preaching all along has come to pass. And Christ responds to John, not through enticing ways, but through the demonstration of power. And even those that had doubted that John had preached the truth, they saw the demonstration of power. And even the disciples of John, they saw it. It may be very possible that those very same disciples that John sent, they were the ones that were murmuring and complaining. That you preached about Christ all this time, now you are imprisoned, and where is the Messiah that you preached about, that he was coming to save us? And after the disciples had gone, they've seen the miracles, the signs that Christ was performing. Then Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, why did you people go out to see in the wilderness? Why? Because these are the same people that John was preaching unto. Remember, when Christ came, he took over the ministry and a whole lot of people and other souls that he then won, but including those that John was ministering unto. Why? Because the ministry of John was going to end the moment that Christ came, because John was just a forerunner. So that you may understand that there are callings that are programmed, and they've got a specific season. And when that season is over, that calling ends. And when that calling ends, those that don't understand the calling of God, they think the Spirit of the Lord has left someone. It did not leave anyone. It would not have left anyone. It would be because that person has finished his assignment in a certain region, in a certain province, in a certain country. And Jesus began to ask those that were around and said, what did you go out to see in the wilderness? And he was referring to John. And he began to give them examples. A reed shaken with the wind, he questioned. A man clothed in soft raiment, he questioned. Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what then did you go out there in the wilderness to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, more than a prophet. The reason why Jesus is saying John is more than a prophet, it means he is actually acknowledging John. And he understands why John had sent two of his disciples. Why? Because this is one that is in prison, but the way that he's still defending the gospel, while he's in prison, he's still fighting for Christ while he's in prison. It means John was still preaching the gospel while he's in prison. This is why he is able to even to send his disciples to go and inquire from Christ if he is the one that has come. Like I said, had it been another disciple, he would have given up and said, I've been preaching about Christ all this time. Now I'm behind sales and Christ has done nothing about it. And Christ is saying, what you went to see out there in the wilderness before I came was more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, There is not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Why? Because he defends the gospel. He defended not just the gospel, but he defended Christ. As they all listened to the gospel of the coming of Christ, they never believed that he was going to come. Up until John was imprisoned, but still he continued to defend the gospel until Christ came. I hope someone is understanding what I'm saying. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence. For all the prophets of the law prophesied until John. And what did Christ mean by saying, and from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffered the violence? He's talking about the violence of those that take it by force. He's talking about the violence of those that defend the gospel. Those that affirm in what they preach. He was not describing the characteristics of John. John did not just preach a soft gospel. He preached a firm gospel. At one time, he tells the Sadducees and the Pharisees and describes them as vipers. And tells them that, do you know that God can create ears on these stones? And he defines a gospel of preaching to stones. He was prepared even to stand on his weight that he has preached. John was not a preacher that would change what he has preached. John was not a preacher that would fear losing people. This is why he ends up saying, I can preach to stones. Child of God, I'm here once again to stand firm and tell you that you have to be strong in the gospel and defend the gospel of Jesus Christ. So many critics are now born in the world. So many hypocrites. So many persecutors. Lucifer himself is the accuser of brethren, but Christ wants to see the courage that you have, the boldness that you have, to stand firm and defend the gospel. The gospel that you have preached needs to be defended. And those that are listening to the gospel also need to be firm and defend that gospel. It's unfortunate that the disciples that we have, the majority of disciples that we now have in this generation, they are not courageous. They are not bold. This is why they don't stand in the way that they have preached. They reverse back their ways when trials and tribulations arise and they befall upon them. The apostles would get beaten, they would get arrested, and they would get thrown into prison, but they would still stand on the weight. Child of God, I'm here to strengthen you once again. Defend the gospel of Jesus Christ with courage and boldness in the name of Jesus. He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions, eclipsed by glory, now I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your effect.